Hello, I'm Gabriel from Lewitt. I'm here with Jake Ellswood. Hey, Jake.
Hi, how's it going?
Fine. Thanks for having us.
No problem at all.
We're here at Metropolis Studios in Studio C, and as you can see, there's a beautiful Neve console behind us, but it has some issues. Jake, he's a studio tech, he will show us how he fixes them. So let's take a closer look.
Cool. So today we've got an issue with channel 9. Mm-hmm. It's the high and low filters on the EQ. They're not working properly. So what we'll do is we'll pull the channel out, we'll take it down to tech, and then I'll show you how we might go about sorting that out.
Mm-hmm. And by not working properly, you mean like, does it crackle or doesn't
it work generally at all? With the filters on the EQ, they just completely stop functioning at all. Mm-hmm. You won't hear any difference. Even if you're, say, you're boosting at like plus 18, you can sweep through both filters, and they're not doing anything at all. So I've got suspicion I know what it is, but yeah, as I say, we'll go down and have a look, and hopefully I know the culprit. Cool, so let's grab it out, take it downstairs, and we'll have a look.
So we're at the repair shop now. Jake, what's actually the most common issues with, let's say, the Neve?
Yeah, sure. So the main issue is that you'll notice just from taking this out, it's actually quite warm. So you can imagine all those channels stacked together. They've all got about an amp of current going through each one of them. They get pretty hot. The main issue is that we've got all these capacitors in the channel that, because they're electrolytic capacitors, they're sort of dielectric, is a liquid. So when the channel gets hot, that liquid is more prone to sort of disappearing, evaporating out of those capacitors.
So they dry up.
Yeah, they dry up, so they don't work as well. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they still work, but just, as I say, not as well, or sometimes they just don't pass signal at all. So that can cause issues, like with our EQ shelves that we were talking about earlier. They just stop functioning because those actually rely on the capacitors to to function then.
And when a capacitor fails, is this like gradually, or is it just like, now I stop working?
It's usually gradually. If you test them with a multimeter, you can see that sometimes, if you've got like a 100 microfarad capacitor in there, it might drop to something like 70 microfarads. So that can do all sorts, especially with an EQ, sort of change the actual values that the filter will slope at, and so lots of different things.
Whatever is written on the knob is no longer
accurate. Yeah, it's no longer accurate at all. Okay.
How many years does a typical capacitor last?
It's hard to say, really. Especially when you bear in mind that this console never gets turned off, so it's on 24/7, 7 days a week, every day of the year. So I would say it's difficult to measure, because sometimes you get a fault and you can't necessarily put it down to a capacitor or not. But I know for a fact that these capacitors in here haven't been changed for several years, so they're, you know, ready to get changed. Let's put it like that. They're in need of a change. So
roughly how many are in one channel strip, do you know?
Well, there's got to be around 200 to 300 in each one. In the small fader alone, in this section here, there's over 120. So
in the fader section?
Yeah, in just the small fader here. So I've not actually counted myself, because I'm sure it would take a long time. But there's definitely an awful lot. And there's you've got these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 modules here, but you've also got a recall section, which is actually the board underneath this one. Mm-hmm. This is the just the connection board that routes everything into the bay of the channel. But you've also got like a small tape output board at the top up here. So even though it might only look like it's a few modules in here, there's actually quite a bit all hidden away as well. So,
hundreds of capacitors, and then there's two solder joints each. So,
yeah, that's a lot of soldering. Currently, I've done about a bay and used a reel of solder doing it, which is quite a lot considering they're tiny little, only tiny little joints. So there's a lot, and there's also a lot of joints to check and make sure they all pass signal. So it's a pretty involved task.
So you said your job here is literally taking care of the Neve.
That's it.
And that's a full-time job.
That's a full-time job.
So if you dream about having a Neve, you might rethink that.
I mean, it's a fantastic design, and they are pretty bulletproof, as you'd expect from a Neve. But you've also got to bear in mind the complexity of this console. It's an absolute beast, really. So taking care of it is a full-time job. I come in on a Monday morning, and do this every day of the week. Go home on a Friday, absolutely exhausted, but love doing it because it's well worth doing. There's not many Neve rooms left in London, and the amount of artists that have come through and recorded through this console, it's well worth keeping it alive. So it's quite
history.
Rewarding. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when you resolder stuff, I guess sometimes the traces.
Yeah, the tracks. Tracks come off definitely.
What happens if you ruin a board?
So there is a way of repairing the boards. It takes quite a lot of time, but as you say, basically you've got all the little routes that the signal takes between all the components, and these channels have been recapped many times throughout its lifetime. Bearing in mind it's from the late 80s, so it's been recapped at least sort of 5, 6, 7 times maybe. And taking those caps in and out all the time will, with heat from a soldering iron, mean that they do start to come away. And these aren't simple boards either. They don't just have track on the back, but they also have it on the front, sometimes in the middle. So you've really got to have a keen eye to be able to make sure that those tracks are intact when you're soldering onto them. Otherwise, when you recap, it's just not going to work again. And you spend twice as long trying to find
what you did.
Yeah, exactly. So the way of repairing them is we take some very fine wire, and we literally find the point where the track has come off.
And make a bridge.
That's it, make a bridge to where it's supposed to be going, which can be pretty fiddly. Mm. I can show you one that I've done later on that's been retracked. And it's also important to make sure that is actually where it's going, because sometimes it's completely invisible. You've got sort of different eras of board in this. And for example, like this really dark green colored board is impossible to see. If a track's come off, it's impossible to see where it's actually going from. So the best thing to do is grab another channel that's working that you've tested, and then you can put sort of a continuity meter across and find which bit's actually connected to.
Somewhere. Okay.
So,
How is that with connectors and switches? Do they get replaced or do you clean them?
The switches generally do need cleaning. They on a VR, they're classic for getting stuck in and not popping back out again, and also being quite crackly as well if they're not maintained well. So
there's just dirt getting in there? Or
dust? That's it. When you pull these out, there's a lot of dust inside them, a lot of dirt, because it gets used every day. So there's not always a chance to go in and make sure it's all clean. As I say, you can imagine if there's a session in there in the morning and doesn't finish till late at night, and then the same again, it's difficult to go in and maintain it. So all the switches generally are much improved by just spraying some contact cleaner on them. And so when I go through a module and replace all the capacitors, I go through, clean all the switches, all the pots as well. And sometimes they just need replacing. We've got lots of spares here, which is quite useful.
So they're still available if you need them?
We've got some available. Whether or not they're easy to get hold of now, if you were buying them new, we're quite lucky because we used to have a VR in our Studio A control room as well. So when that moved on, we also have loads of spares from that as well.
Moved on, is like you cannibalized it? Or?
Oh, no, no, no. Okay. I believe that was sold off complete. But having, you can imagine having two VRs, we got hold of a lot of spares for them.
Makes sense.
So we hung on to a lot of those spares when the Studio A console moved on, which is great because it means we have lots of spare channels. So if we do have a module that has particularly bad tracks, we can just grab another module from a spare channel, put that in. That means we can fix it faster, make sure it's all working and put it in a session. Rather than just spending weeks and weeks down here just fixing little tracks, we can do that later on.
And could we, now we see a Neve, could we have like a look to compare it to like an SSL channel?
Yeah, by all means, yeah. Our other three main studios here run off SSL, so we've got loads of those that I can show you, definitely.
Cool. Then we'll grab a channel and we'll be right back. What am I holding in my hands?
So you are holding an SSL 9000 channel. Mm-hmm. And you'll notice on here that it has far less capacitors than on the Neve. And that's basically because it's a DC coupled console. So on the Neve, each sort of section is separated by capacitors, which is a very good way of doing it. But the issue is with it that more components in a tightly compact space get hot, and then we're back to the heat issue again.
Yeah, okay. So these generally tend to be more reliable, or?
Yeah, from my experience, we get less issues with them. And you'll notice as well, going back to the heat issue, that this is just a single-sided board, so everything is on the back board with only a few on the top, but it makes it far more open, so you get much more ventilation through the channel, so it's nice and cool.
I see a lot of ICs here.
Yeah.
Do they ever break, and are they hard to replace?
Yeah, they do, definitely. We even had an issue upstairs in our Studio E with the monitor card recently, and that was put down to an IC related issue. Okay. Once that was changed, we're back up and running.
So, but are they still in production, or is it like?
It's difficult. Some of them are. We've got some spares, but the one that we had to replace upstairs in the monitor card, we had to borrow from a channel while we got some. And luckily, SSL actually had some that they were kind enough to send over to us. But yeah, we did struggle. So it can be a little bit of a task to get hold of, but. As I say, it's well worth doing because it keeps them around. And there's not many studios around that
with such that, big consoles.
Yeah, with such big consoles and so many rooms to sort of facilitate artists that want to use them. So
cool. Can you show us what kind of documentation or manuals you get when you buy an SSL?
Yeah, definitely. There's quite a lot. Let's go have a look. So in here, it's just a small selection of the manuals that we have. These are all service manuals, so you can see a lot of SSL manuals in there. They are for three consoles, but there's an awful lot of helpful documents in there that will help you track down faults throughout the consoles.
So these are all the schematics, everything?
All the schematics, yeah.
So if you had way too much spare time, you could build your own console based on this?
In theory, you could, yeah. Lots of spare time, and it will be a lot of hunting for those parts that are difficult to get. But these get used. These are invaluable because when a part goes down on that, it's not always obvious where it might be. So they definitely a bit of a lifesaver.
Thank you very much.
Cool, no problem at all.
Thank you for watching and see you next time.